Good afternoon. So I'm going to talk about the ARTEMIS experiment for precision measurement of electron G factor in the case of highly charged ions, that is the bound state electron G factor. So coming over some of the measurement principles in a Penning trap. A Penning trap is a device which uses the electric field as well as the magnetic field to trap the charged particles. In our case, it's highly charged ions. So we have, when a particle is in a magnetic field, an ion is in a magnetic field, so the ion will have a cyclotron frequency, a cyclotron motion with a frequency omega c, and the electron which is bound to the ion, that will have Larmor precision around the magnetic field with a frequency omega l. And from here we can derive a relation for g, that is the g factor we want to calculate, and we can see the relation here. So what we want to measure with our experiment is the ratio between omega L and omega C. The rest we can obtain from the numbers. So let's have a look how we measure this ratio. First, I'll talk about the measurement of omega C, that is the cyclotron frequency. To go through that, I'll talk briefly about the ion motion in a Penning trap. So in a Penning trap, as I mentioned, we have the electric field as well as the magnetic field. So when an ion is present in a electric field, it will have an axial oscillation because the electric field will confine the particle axially. Whereas in a magnetic field, which is along the axial direction, the radial confinement of the ion will be there, and thus we have the axial motion and the modified cyclotron motion because we have electric field present along with the magnetic field, and we also have a magnetron drift. So the motion is somewhat like cyclotron and then axial and then magnetron, all the three together. And then we also have a Gabriel's invariance theorem which relates all these three frequencies to give us the free cyclotron frequency. So further, I'll talk about the ARTEMIS experiment, that is the asymmetric trap for the measurement of electron magnetic moment in ions. So this is a picture of the trap that we have in our experiment. This trap can be considered to be divided into two parts. The first is the ion production part, which we also call the creation trap, because this trap will create, in our experiment for now, we are using argon 13 plus ions, and these ions we create using FEP over here. And this trap, this part of the trap is also responsible for the in-flight capture of the ions when we connect it further to the high trap setup. And there's another part, that is the spectroscopy part of the trap, where the spectroscopical measurements are done. So this trap now lies here in the ultra high vacuum chamber. This is at a vacuum of about 10 to the power minus 16 millibars. And this is a radiation shield. So we have a two-stage cooling in our experiment, which is this radiation shield is at the first stage of cooling, which is at 45 Kelvin, and we have another stage at the 4 Kelvin where all this experimental setup rests. So we have non-destructive detection techniques. So for that we use the resonators. We have one resonator, that is the axial resonator for the creation trap to detect whether the ions are present or not, and we also have a cyclotron resonator and an axial resonator for the spectroscopy trap to measure the corresponding frequencies. Further, we have these stranded copper wires which would allow to decouple the vibrations that we have from the cooler. And so from here we have the whole setup. Now is this what we saw in the last picture, and this is the two-stage cooling process, which is by the cryo cooler. And now, due to this thermal bridge, which is made of oxygen-free high thermal conductivity copper, so we connect it using this about 1 meter length. And now this, due to this connection, we have the whole of this setup at 4 Kelvin. And here we have a gas valve at present for the injection of the gas into the trap. So we need a strong magnetic field and quite homogeneous. So the magnetic field is of the order of 7 Tesla, which is by a superconducting magnet, and it's running in persistent mode since 2009, and we supplied a current of 210 amperes. And yeah, we have low temperatures, and we are not dealing with single ion in the trap. We have a cloud of ions of about 10 to the power 3 to 10 to the power 4 ions. And we need large optical access, which I'll discuss later why we need that. So coming to the ion production techniques, we can produce ion in two ways. One can be in situ production of ions, which is what we do now for the argon 13+. So we have a gas inlet here. This is the valve. This is known as flotte-lotte because of the shape. And it's a special valve because so what it has is that this particular shape will provide it a large area and the gases will be absorbed. But since this will be also at 4 Kelvin, so it will be frozen. But when we want the gas to be injected, we simply turn the heat on for some time, which we decide, and then let the gas in. Because here, from the gas bottle, the pressure is about 0.6 millibars. And inside the trap chamber, it's 10 to the power minus 16. So it's efficient to maintain this pressure difference between the two sides. And here we have the FEP, field emission point, and then electrons, we have the cold electrons inside here in the trap. So this is the creation part of the trap. And here we have the electrons which interact with the argon gas atoms. And then we have different charge states. To select a particular charge state, we further use Swift technique, that is the stored waveform inverse Fourier transform technique. So this is the in situ production of ions. Another technique that we'd be using, that would be ex situ production of the ions, that would be at the high trap facility at GSI. And from here we would get heavy, highly charged ions like hydrogen, like bismuth and lead and uranium for the further measurements. So next I come to laser microwave double resonance spectroscopy technique, which we use for the measurement of Larmor frequency. So we saw that we need two frequencies, Larmor frequency and the cyclotron frequency. The cyclotron frequency we measure using the resonators, and the Larmor frequency we measure using the laser microwave double resonance spectroscopy technique. So when an ion is in a magnetic field, the energy levels would split because of the Zeeman effect. And thus, this for the case of say argon 13+, if I consider, so this frequency omega 6, that is in the visible region. We have the wavelength of about 441 nanometers for this. And the frequency omega A and omega D, these are in the microwave region. This is omega A is 130 gigahertz, and omega D, we have 65 gigahertz. So what we do when we excite a transition from state plus 1 by 2, 1 by 2 to 3 by 2 plus 3 by 2 state, then this some of the ions would be now present in this 3 by 2 state. And because the ions will now decay to only one mode to 1 by 2 state, so there would be a fluorescence observed. But when we scan the microwave of a frequency about omega A, what we observe that some of the ions from 3 by 2 would go to 1 by 2, and then there would be a decrease in the fluorescence. So this decrease in the fluorescence will give us a frequency at which, so the frequency at which there is a decrease in the fluorescence, that is the frequency of this transition, or we say that is the Larmor frequency for this particular transition. And so we can say that the light from the optical transitions is used to probe the Zeeman transitions. Yeah, and for this, because we want to detect the fluorescence, and this is the reason why we have not one ion but large number of ions, because for single ion it's not possible to detect the fluorescence. And we have large solid angles so as to detect the light emitted. So for this we have a trap design that we discussed. It's a half open trap, penning trap, cylindrical. We can have a closed end cap design, but it's closed, so no optical access. But if we have a completely open end cap trap, so it will have a very small solid angle. It's not visible clearly, but it's written 0.2 steradians. But if we improve this design by using an indium tin oxide coated window, which has special property that it is electrically conducting so as to act as a Faraday cup, and it's also transparent, as we can see from the curve, that it has 77% of transparency or transmission to the light we need now. It's 441. So it's a pretty good number. And yeah, from here we have this special trap design for the spectroscopy part of the trap. So now coming over to the non-destructive detection technique, as I already discussed, this is for the measurement of cyclotron frequency. We have different types of resonators which we produce for the experiment. We make them on our own. That can be helical or toroidal, and we can also use superconducting wires or non-superconducting wires for the measurements. So we have approximately 8 types of resonators, and we select the particular combinations that we need. And we have this offline test stand for the resonators, where we test our resonators for the quality factor and the resonance frequency before inserting into the trap. Because so if you remember this whole apparatus, it's difficult to remove the trap out, work with it, and then put it back in. So to know beforehand, we test it in the resonators. And one such measurement that I have here is for the different temperatures. So in the test stand also, we have a cooler, cryo cooler, and the temperature goes from 2.7 to, so it can go as low as 2.7 Kelvin here. And we also have a pump here, so we can pump it out for better vacuum here. And we have different measurements for the quality factor, how it varies with temperature. This is for niobium titanium wire, the resonator made of a niobium titanium wire, and it's a dual core axial resonator. So coming over to the measurements, so this is one of the measurements that we have up to now for the creation trap of the ARTEMIS experiment. So what we see, we have different peaks corresponding to different charge states, and we have also some of the tungsten ions available, so we see different spectra. So what we use is the Swift technique to remove the unwanted ion species in the first go, and then further to select a particular charge state, we again apply the Swift technique, and we get a particular charge state, the ion cloud with just one type of ions, and then we are able to transport it to the spectroscopy trap for the further spectroscopical measurements. So coming over to the conclusions and outlook, and so up to now we are successful in having the in-trap production and storage of highly charged ions. We have stored it for weeks. And now we are looking forward to the laser microwave double resonance technique to be implemented, and which would lead to the measurement of G factor for, firstly, for boron-like argon ions. And then in the future, we aim to measure it for lead, bismuth, and uranium when we are able to connect it to the high-trap facility. And the connection is also underway. I mean, the last part of the beamline that connects the ARTEMIS experiment to the high-trap beamline is also under process. I think it should be done by this year. Yeah, and these are my team, and thank you.